الله أكبر الله أكبر الله
بسم الله الحمد لله السلام عليكم peace be unto you welcome to the Dean Show which is a way of life we try to put out there for everyone to see helping you understand Islam and Muslims and we have a special guest on the Dean Show today Suhaib Webb
children of the world come together and hear the call sing children of the world Islam will unite us all sing children of the world
Assalamu alaikum brother
Assalamu alaikum, how you doing
peace
man?
Be unto you, welcome to the Dean Show thank you for coming on the Dean Show alhamdulillah all praises to Allah God I thank you for coming out. How are you doing?
It's my pleasure. It's good. Everything's fine. I'm traveling around and stopped off in Chicago and found you.
Alhamdulillah. So we brought you on the Dean Show today. We want to ask you a few questions. We heard that you weren't always Muslim. How long ago did you accept Islam?
I became Muslim 15 years ago at the age of 20.
At the age of 20?
Yeah.
And before this you were?
I was a Christian.
Were you a practicing Christian?
Not really, but I was raised in that environment. I was somewhat of a practicing Christian.
As a Christian, what did you believe?
I believed in the Trinity.
And you know what this was?
Yeah, definitely.
Did you ever hear of the Bible?
Yeah, my grandfather was a preacher. He founded a Christian college. So
okay.
As far as knowledge, I had a lot of knowledge of Christianity.
So you believed in the Trinity?
Yeah, the whole nine yards. Original sin.
Okay, you know, somebody baptism, died for your sins?
Yeah, the Lamb of God, the whole nine yards.
Okay, so somebody would say like, man.
So from a point of view of literacy, I was very literate.
Yes.
My issue is I didn't believe it, so I didn't practice.
So could somebody say, look, this brother didn't know his Bible, this brother didn't know
his
Christianity?
No, you didn't say that. I went to church three times a week.
Three times a week?
Yeah.
Okay. So at what point in your life did you make a turn?
I would say early on as a youngster when I first started learning about the concept of the Trinity and just not being able to digest that God could be three or one of three, that there was a lamb who had to be sent to die for my sins.
Who's this lamb you're talking about?
Jesus.
Jesus. Okay.
When I had studied, even in the church, basically the Old Testament, that God Almighty is the one who forgives sins, and he's the all-powerful, magnificent, awesome God. So I was like, there are two gods. There's a God of the Old Testament, and there's a new Pauline-type God, which appears in passages in the New Testament.
So this started to not make sense to you?
Yeah, immediately it didn't make sense to me. As soon as I heard it, it didn't make sense.
Did you go up to your higher ups, some of the priests?
I went to my mother and I asked her, you know, we believe that Jesus, the Son of God, he died for our sins. He's a sacrificial lamb. She said, yes. And I said, and that's the key to salvation. Baptism is the key to salvation. And she said, yes. And I said, well, what about the prophets who preceded him, who didn't believe in him? They didn't, Abraham prayed to one God. Moses prayed to one God. Jesus himself didn't ever acknowledge that he was God. He prayed to God himself. So what's the deal? And she couldn't explain it to me.
Okay, now from here, what role did you start to lead? Did you leave Christianity? Did you go and start to investigate other religions?
I mean, most definitely we can say all religions have a lot of beneficial things about them.
Yeah.
Especially in the area of character and so on. So anyone who turns his back from any tradition, religious tradition, is gonna collapse ethically. For the most part. So I went into kind of a gang lifestyle, hip-hop lifestyle, drugs,
I heard you
DJing.
You were a DJ, yeah.
Yeah, DJing and so on and so forth, and became really immersed into that subculture. At that time, hip-hop was definitely a subculture. It wasn't, you know, like you see it now everywhere.
So tell me this. Okay, so we got away from the concept of God being a Trinity. Okay, this didn't make sense. And the whole thing, was it difficult? Because you had a one-way ticket. A ticket now, as Christians believe, if I take Jesus as my Lord and Savior, it's finished. I got a free ride. For some people, it's hard to disattach because it's like that lotto ticket.
No doubt that it was a tough decision to make theologically because I was raised that way for so long. So I actually took 3 years to become Muslim. I didn't become Muslim in a fly-by-night thing. I sat down and read the Quran, read a few books about Islam.
How'd you get a hold of the Quran?
I went to the library and checked it out.
But was there something, because was there a stigma at that time, like there is today, about Islam that...
Again, because of hip-hop, I was pretty culturally literate.
Yeah.
So I knew what the Quran was by listening to hip-hop. So I knew that it was the Book of the Muslims, and I just wanted to go read it.
So something just, you were searching?
And there was always a feeling in the streets that the Muslims were right.
It was a feeling.
Unfortunately, that's changed now because many Muslims are engaged in bad things.
Yeah.
In all areas, especially in the bad neighborhoods where they're selling pork and beer and poison to people, that image has been kind of hurt. But in those days, we, because of Malcolm X specifically and his conversion, we saw Muslims as like our last anchor for like salvation and to get ourselves correct. We always said, look, man, if you want to get yourself correct, go with the Muslims over there.
Yeah?
They'll straighten you out.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So this is what happened. You wanted to get straightened out, or you were looking to get straightened out, or life was kind of a mess? Or?
I had success as far as material success, but internally I was very empty.
Uh-huh.
So I was, you know, asking myself, why do you feel depressed? Why do you feel sad if you have, you know, girls, the money, the DJ in the clubs, the Bloods, the gang I belong to, everything is going well, but why internally do you feel this emptiness? And then I realized that the only way to quench that spiritual thirst was to race and discover who the Creator was.
Can God be a man? Is that possible for God to be a man?
No, not at all.
Why is that?
Because God is unlike His creation. If we make God like His creation, we'll start to worship His creation. But the one who has the right to be worshipped has to be unique, different than everything else. He can't be like His creation. Because Allah says in the Quran, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. There's nothing like God. You cannot make God's image. That's why in the Old Testament it says, do not make my image. Don't try to make the image of God. So if we make Him creation, the first question is, what color is He? What does He look like? So you go to a church, for example, you see Ricky Martin is God. You go to another church, it's you know, Barry White. You go to another church and it's Axl Rose. Who's God? So when we make God a man, we immediately create injustice in society by making one man better than another man.
And tell me now, you said that God can't be a man. That's quite simple. And in Islam, it clearly differentiates God from His creation. Is
that
correct?
Definitely.
Okay. How about God having a son? Can God have a son?
No, He cannot, because the same argument applies. If He has a son, then that makes Him like His creation. Then what color was His son? What did He look like? What was His shape? What language did He speak?
Okay.
So immediately when we throw that into the mix, we allow other human beings to be unjust to other human beings. That's the whole doctrine of sham that you see in the Old Testament, where people say that the black man is cursed or the white man is cursed because they were the sons of Noah, and then Jesus came. And this led basically to some, you know, some very sick ideologies and philosophies.
A few more points, and then we'll come to a close. Tell us, what is Islam? But before that, real quick, you mentioned the word Allah. What is this for someone who's never heard this term, Allah? What does this mean?
Allah is the Arabic word for God. And it's a little bit different than the English word because it cannot be given a feminine tense or a plural tense. You just say Allah. You can't say Allah like a woman or Allahs with an S or an ES. And also it means the absolute unique possessor of attributes and qualities which nothing is even remotely like Him. Unique, awesome in his power, extremely merciful. This is Allah. The one who has the right to be worshipped. The name itself means the one who has the right to be worshipped. It's His right, because we see people worshipping things all the time, brother. Worshipping drugs, worshipping cars, worshipping girls, worshipping fame, worshipping their bodies. When we work out, you see all them guys looking in the mirror.
Yeah.
You just lifted weights, you know, you didn't change, man.
Yeah.
There's not that much blood being pumped into your muscles right now. But the idea of worship is innate to the human being. We've been created to worship. So if we don't worship the Creator, we'll worship something else.